Focus your eyes on this swinging watch. You're getting sleepy, very sleepy. And now, when I snap my fingers, you will watch this whole video.
Hypnosis, is it just a party trick or can it be used as a tool for therapy? Should I be scared of it, like how it's shown in movies? Or can it really transform our lives? Let's find out.
You may have seen hypnotists make people fall asleep on command, quack like a duck, or even change personalities, like in some movies where they portray these performances can make hypnosis seem pretty questionable for an average skeptical person. So is there really that kind of power in a soothing voice and a swinging watch? Well, the good news is hypnosis isn't just a party trick. There are now clear scientific evidences that being hypnotized is possible. And yes, definitely it causes some real changes to our brain. Some psychologists even use this as a therapy to help patients with a bunch of physical and mental conditions. Now the evidence is clear, hypnosis is real. It is not an exaggerated brainwashing that you may think or as shown in the movies. For thousands of years, it has been documented that there are certain meditations that can induce the same state of trance as in hypnosis. What we now consider modern hypnosis began in 1700s, thanks to a physician called Franz Mesmer. This is where we got the word mesmerize. Mesmer had a theory about the nature that he called animal magnetism. But he was not just talking about sex appeal. He thought that there were invisible magnetic fluids that flowed through every living creature. Mesmer claimed that he could cure people for all kinds of illnesses by adjusting that flow. Using dim lights, ethereal music, magnets and flashy hand gesture, Mesmer induced a trance-like state. In some of his clients, he tried to balance this invisible fluid. Yes, some of Mesmer's patients did get healthier after his treatments. But when the scientific community put the theory of animal magnetism to the test, they found this magnetic fluid with healing powers was not a real thing. So Mesmer and his research was discredited and obviously didn't make the kind of wave it was supposed to be back then. Fast forward to mid-1800s, the surgeon named James Braid began to study this potential therapy. He was the one to coin the word hypnosis to describe it from the Greek word hypnos, because he thought the trance-like state was very similar to sleep. Nowadays, clinical psychologists think hypnosis only seems like drowsiness when it's actually a focused psychological state, kind of similar to meditation. And indeed, unlike the flashy hypnotism that you see in TVs and movies, clinical hypnosis is pretty simple. It is all about focus. So hypnosis usually takes place in a dimly lit, quiet room. Sometimes there is gentle music playing, but the goal is to remove all distraction. The hypnotist speaks softly, encourages the client to focus their attention on something, like maybe a dangling watch, and walks them through some relaxation exercises. Eventually, they will reach a state of focused relaxation, which just means that they are calm, focused, and more open to suggestions. That way, hypnosis can guide their clients through different visualization and instructions, depending upon the goals of hypnotherapy. Pretty simple, right? Clinical psychologists agree that the relaxed and focused trance is the goal of hypnotherapy. But there are two main theories about being hypnotized actually means psychologically. The altered state theory says that hypnosis actually leads a distinct state of consciousness. Kind of like sleep, hypnosis might be a distinct state of brain where the mental processes work differently and you are not necessarily aware of what is happening if you are awake. On the flip side, non-state theory says that hypnosis is more like a role play. Instead of being in distinct state, hypnosis might be a combination of intense focus and certain expectations about what is supposed to be when it means to be hypnotized. Basically, you are still aware and just playing along. So right now, researchers need more evidence to figure out what being hypnotized really means in psychological sense. But they have found out that different people are more or less easily hypnotized. Hypnotize is a voluntary process. So people have to be willing to listen to hypnotists, focus and relax. But researchers estimate that about 10 to 15% people are highly hypnotizable, meaning they slip more easily into the hypnotic trance or state during a session. Another 20% are pretty resistant to hypnosis, and rest of us fall somewhere in the between. It is still exactly not very clear what makes a person highly hypnotized or not. However, one study found evidence that it might have to do with slight variation in the brain anatomy. These researchers used magnetic resonance imaging, or also called as the MRI, and found out the subjects who were easily hypnotized had a significant larger rostrum than for those who weren't. The rostrum is the region in the brain involved in attention. Other scientists wanted to look at the brainwave patterns of hypnotized people. Basically, our brain depends on electromechanical energy to work, because that is how our neurons communicate with each other. By using an electroencephalogram, or also called as EEG, researchers can monitor the electrical activity of our brain and see different patterns of brainwaves. In studies, researchers found that hypnosis, especially in highly hypnotizable people, leads to an increase in theta waves. That's where you must have heard somewhere about, called as theta healing, which are linked to attention and visualization, like when we are doing mental math or daydreaming. So MRIs and EEG seem to show that hypnosis can affect our brains, pay attention to things, which supports the idea that it's a state of focused relaxation. But how does this focused relaxation state, less hypnotist make suggestions and influence of what clients think or do? Well, that has to do with a concept called top-down processing. Our brains receive a lot of sensory information from the world around us, but we do a lot of processing and interpretation to figure out what is going on. The idea of top-down processing is that you expect from memories and assumptions. The top-level information can have an impact on what you perceive with your senses. The bottom-level information, cognitive scientists have known this for a very long time, that there are a lot of different experiments to show this particular effect. For example, a group of researchers had people drink wine that they thought was expensive and the wine they thought was cheap. However, the fact was it was actually the same wine. But the people said they enjoyed the expensive wine more than the cheaper one, probably because they expected it to taste better. Not only that, but a pleasure processing part of the brain became more active when they drank the expensive wine. Top-down processing also explains this placebo effect. What is placebo? If a doctor gives you a pill and says it'll make you better, you're probably gonna say that it does, even if the pill is actually just a sugar pill. Basically, it means that because a hypnotized person is much more open to suggestions, their expectations can be tweaked, and which is also the change they perceive the world. University of California came up with this scientific evidence that yes, hypnosis can affect the perception like this. Take the Stroop's test, for example, where you look at the bunch of words describing colors like red, green and blue. But instead of reading the printed word, you have to say the color of the ink in which the word is printed in. So if the word yellow is printed in blue ink, for example, you have to say blue. It is pretty hard to do because there's a conflict in the task. Your brain is processing the word and the color of the word at the same time. So a team of neuroscientists decide to use a Stroop test to see if hypnosis could affect how people perceive the words and their colors by using a functional MRI to monitor their brain activity. The researchers used the relaxation technique that hypnotized a mix of people who are highly hypnotizable, less hypnotizable, and the subjects were given the very specific suggestion. The words they should see from the fMRI scanners were gibberish, and they had to identify the colors shown as quickly as possible. A couple of days after a hypnosis session, the subjects took the Stroop test while having their brain scanned, and highly hypnotizable people were probably more receptive to their suggestion. They were faster and more accurate by picking up the colors of the word. Even more amazingly, there were measurable differences in their brain activity. Specifically, a brain region responsible for decoding written words didn't get activated at all. So their brains didn't seem to be recognizing the words as words. At the same time, their brains didn't seem to register any conflict in the task, unlike the brains of participants who were resistant to hypnotherapy. So it seems like hypnotic suggestion did change subjects' expectation. So they perceived gibberish instead of the words and could focus on only the colors. A different study by neuroscientists even found that hypnosis could block memories. The subject watched a 45-minute film and came back a week later to be hypnotized. They were given a suggestion to forget the film when they heard a certain cue, and they could have their memory restored with another cue. These participants entered the fMRI scanner and given the forgetting cue. After that, they were given a test and they couldn't remember the details of the movie, even though they could not remember the details of the room they watched in it. Plus, certain memory-related regions of their brains weren't active. This phenomenon is known as post-hypnotic amnesia. Some hypnotists use this just as a fun party trick, but however, serious scientists have found this kind of a hypnosis is a very useful tool for medicine and psychology. Some surgeons have used hypnosis before operations for medical treatment to reduce pain, anxiety, and help the recovery become much more faster. Hypnosis is widely used during childbirth to reduce anxiety and pain. Hypnotherapy is sometimes used in combination with other behavioral therapies for a bunch of conditions like quitting smoking, to mental illnesses and conditions like depression or PTSD. At the same time, hypnosis isn't a cure for all, and hypnotic suggestions won't help everyone. So, is hypnosis real? Yes, definitely. But even psychologists aren't exactly sure about what being hypnotized really means. Some think it's a distinct state of consciousness, while others think that being hypnotized is more about concentration and expectation. Mostly, hypnosis just highlights how powerful our brains are. If you don't want to relax and to be put in sleep, you won't be. But you could possibly change the perception of the world to reduce physical pain or even force you to forget sometimes.
Hello everybody, my name is Dr. Sachin and I am a life coach. I use games, activities and exercises to teach young champions valuable life skills and study skills, which help them become number one in studies and number one in life. Continue to watch our videos, share them, subscribe to our channel, and please do comment. It'll help us and inspire us to make more good content like this. Thank you so much for watching our channel. Also do visit our website. Thank you so much.